But yeah, it's an interesting topic to talk about. And I think in order to really talk about it, probably the first place to start is just with a kind of an explanation in a way of what is actually goes on when we actually have surgery. So bear with me. I know that probably a lot of you have already know this in a fair degree of detail, but what we see on the screen at the moment is the kind of the intricate anatomy that goes on with men with prostates. The prostate's located and it's snugged right between the kind of the base of the penis here and the bladder itself. And of course, surgically resecting that causes trauma. What's not on the picture is that down at the base here, there's actually the striated urethral sphincter is present. And so any time that the surgeon is going to cut down through there, it means that they're going to induce some degree of trauma as a result of that kind of surgical incision. This is then removed, and then the end of the stump of the urethra is stitched back up, a bit like a plumbing job. And of course, just because the tubes are connected doesn't necessarily mean that the continence is restored following surgery. And there's good reason as to why that might be the case. I guess the next thing I wanted to talk about was that now that we know that, okay, you've had a problem with the prostate, it's been removed and it's induced some degree of trauma to the system, probably the next stage is to actually classify what we mean by post-prostatectomy incontinence. And I guess that what's really interesting is that we used to just classify it as stress urinary incontinence or urgency urinary incontinence or a mixed bag between the two. But in fact, part of the research that I'm doing at the moment is actually looking at maybe classifying this even better. Because in a way, what we've got is a series of different types of leakers. We've got heavy leakers. And these people are the people that go through high volumes and very wet pads. They're possibly the hardest group to treat, but they leak all day and all night, a constant drip, drip, drip from the penis. We get a different category, which is a moderate leaker. Now, these people are often dry at night. That's one of the ways that we can kind of differentially categorize them. They're dry at night, they're completely fine. But during the day, the minute they get up against gravity or the minute they try and do things, that's when the continence kind of gets worse. And then we have a very light leaker who really tend to only leak at the end of the day, so that they're fine in the mornings, but as the day progresses, they tend to notice that the pads get heavier towards the back end of the day. And of course, there can be slight mixtures between those, and some people who are heavy all day still notice that at the end of the day, they are significantly worse. So there's a way in which they can kind of correlate. And then of course we have people, and this normally is not just the post-prostatectomy, this is also from the radiation therapy cohort, will often suffer with urgency and frequency issues, overactive bladder kind of symptoms. Now what's interesting is that when you think about the treatments for incontinence, really, Kegel exercises is the one thing that kind of comes straight to mind. But what I'm trying to say at the moment is that in fact, just throwing one solution at a problem that is multifaceted, it may not be the best way to go. So in fact, the treatment, the actual intervention for the problem may depend actually on the kind of problem that you've got in the first place. So not all treatments are the same. When we think about rehabilitation of any problem, whether it's a reconstructed shoulder or a replaced knee, there's an importance in what we call sequential rehabilitation. In other words, you can't put the front door on a building until you've dug the foundation stones first. There has to be a set sequence in which we approach. So in terms of what we think about with pelvic floor rehabilitation, one of the first things that we should logically do is to actually identify the individual muscles that have been traumatized by the surgical process. Once we've identified it, only then can we actually target it for development. And what do we mean by development? Well, we can break the function of a muscle into three main elements: the speed of a muscle, the strength of the muscle, and the ability of the muscle to function over a period of time. Once we've actually developed the muscle, it kind of looks good in a tight t-shirt, but it can't play tennis. So it's the muscles are there, but we have to actually then integrate it into some degree of functional use. Now that's true of rehabilitation of a shoulder or a knee or any other part of the human body, but we don't tend to apply that same rehabilitation philosophy for post-prostatectomy incontinence. What tends to happen is what we see in golf, which is if you want to hit the ball harder, if you want to hit the ball further, you hit the ball harder. And we know that, in fact, hitting the ball harder doesn't always give us the outcome that we're looking for. In fact, sometimes if we actually go back to the first stage and actually identify the technique that you're approaching with it, then in fact maybe we can improve the end outcome as a result of that. So I think what we're trying to say here is that just trying harder and harder and harder and harder, if it's not producing the outcome that we're looking for, then maybe we have to reevaluate and go back to the beginning again and see whether the foundation stones need to be relayed. This is where it gets a little bit tricky. The mechanics of urinary control. Now, this is a slide that's actually taken from a colleague of mine up at the University of Queensland. He's a guy called Ryan Stafford, and he's a genius. And what he realized was that, in fact, different muscles move in different directions. We used to think of the pelvic floor, and it's still purported in the media at large, as being a hammock. Have you all heard that explanation? Going from your bottom, down underneath you, and up to your pubic symphysis in the front. Well, in fact, it's a little bit more complicated than that. You know, it would be nice to think of it like a hammock, and in a way it does line the internal aspect of the bowl of the pelvic cavity, but there's not just one muscle that slings right the way through. And in fact, the more we dissect and the more we kind of study it, what we realize is there are a number of muscles that function in this arena. The large, big black line is a muscle called levator ani, and it attaches right into the corner of where your rectum is. As you would expect with a name like levator ani, its primary function is to close the anal passage. We've got the striated urethral sphincter, which is just on the top end, or it's just underneath the prostate. It's kind of between the prostate and the penis itself. And when we look at when it goes from a relaxed to a contracted state, it seems to move in an opposite direction, down in this fashion from here. And then we've got a third muscle called bulbar cavernosus, which is at the base of the penis. And again, when that muscle contracts, it produces a movement in this direction. What you can also see is that the tube itself is kind of kinked. Now, I don't know how many of you are gardeners here, but if you want to stop the flow of fluid through a hose pipe, one of the best things to do is to pick the point where it's already kinked and kink it a little bit further. Yeah? So what we seem to see is that the levator ani is actually a distance away from that. And this is the way that historically a lot of men have been trained. Stop yourself from breaking wind is a very common kind of phrase that we're often told to drive that power through. And because you can feel that, that's the one that you tend to want to get stuck into. So you put all your effort into trying to contract from the large black line, when in reality, this scissor-like effect, can you see how the two muscles are going to produce almost like a pinching effect around the urethra? Maybe these muscles are the ones that we really need to identify and teach men how they feel. Because until you know how a muscle feels, it's very difficult to know how then to kind of progress on from that point in time. So now that we know that these muscles exist, of course, the next logical question is, well, how do we show men how to do that? Because I'm doing a contraction right now, and now I'm not. And of course, that's very difficult to teach all of you because, like, it's an internal sensation thing, and how do I make you aware of whether you're on the track or not? So when there's an inherent ability for a dominant muscle to tend to take over and two quiet kids in the back of the room that want to stay very quiet, what we've got to do is really give you better feedback as to how to achieve that. And that's where this thing down here comes in. This is an ultrasound. And this is the same technology that we use to measure babies, only hopefully we don't find any babies in this situation. Or if we do, maybe that's can earn a lot of money somewhere. But anyway, so the ultrasound transducer's down here and it's shining a light. Imagine it like a torch. It's shining a light internally and we're actually able to read off the images. And this is what we see. Now, again, everyone's going, oh, great, because that doesn't look like anything at all. But in fact, what I'm going to do, and you have to kind of squint a little bit for this one, is on this side of the screen here, we've got the relaxed image. And what we can see, again, if you squint quite carefully, is a kind of a tube that runs down and away. Can you kind of all visualize that to a degree? The other thing that's very clear to see is a dark tube here with a little northerly spike. Now, this area down here is the penis. This is the urethra, and this is the levator ani pathway. Do you remember from that last slide, if I just go back, you can actually see that corner of the tube? Well, that is what we're looking at right there. So what we want to see when we look at this image is exactly what's going on here. Can you see the tube now in the urethra as being kinked? So this is someone who's got a good ability to identify the more anterior musculature, okay? With a lot of patients, who we can also see, if you look at the actual anal pathway, you can see that it's relatively similar in both images. Again, an indication that, in fact, they're not over-dominating with their levator ani pathway. Someone who was, for example, what we would see is this corner would probably be off the screen at that stage. So again, we'd see different images. And part of my job is to look at enough men to be able to spot these patterns and then try and scientifically prove that these patterns correlate to people who have ongoing incontinence issues. And we're still in the process of working on that. Again, to simplify that image, we've got this dark tube, and that's the tube that came through the base of the penis and then headed up north. That's the urethra. This is the bulb of the penis down here, and this is the corner of that anal pathway. What we see, and again, I don't want to make you feel completely confounded by it, but this is the start position and finish position. And what you see with a levator ani contraction is a movement upwards and inwards. With bulbar cavernosus, we see the tissues move together here, and with the striated urethral sphincter, we see them move there, again indicating this pincer-like effect that we're trying to kind of generate. We've yet to see whether this correlates to the amount of movement that we see correlates to strength. We don't know whether it is a strength issue or whether it's a control issue, but certainly people that are tugging at their hose pipe and moving it north, well, if I pull at a hose pipe, it doesn't necessarily slow the flow of fluid through the middle of it. But if I kink the hose pipe, I'm much more likely to create an outcome. So again, this is one of the ways in which we're looking at trying to work on the part of pelvic floor training that is often overlooked. You know, it's the quality of the contraction in its first state. If we get that quality wrong, everything that we're trying to build on top of that is compromised by the fact that we may not even be identifying the right muscle in the first place. So that brings us to the identification process. Okay, can we identify the right muscle? But the muscle in itself is not just a voluntary muscle. Okay, because if I'm fast asleep, I don't wet the bed. Okay, and yet for some people, they do wet the bed after surgery because there's a lack of this autonomic element. The internal layer of the sphincter muscle is actually under autonomic control. It means that I'm working it right now. And if you're not leaking right now, you're working your autonomic sphincter too. The bladder system is a double system. There's the bladder itself, which is a storage device, and a sphincter muscle at the bottom. Both of them are muscles. The bladder itself will relax and fill, but the sphincter muscle has to work. And that has to happen at the same time, automatically. When the bladder starts to contract, of course, the sphincter's job is to relax. That has to happen too, otherwise we don't pass any urine. So there's the reciprocal arrangement that goes on between these that's controlled by the autonomic nervous system. So if we wanted to challenge that autonomic system to work harder, I can't make a voluntary decision to strengthen my autonomic muscles. That would be like me saying to myself, I'm going to train the hairs on my arm to stand up or lay down, which would be a hell of a party trick, but it wouldn't really, it's not under my control. But what I can to make that happen is I can create a cold environment and then a hot environment. I can make that happen. So in a way, if we can adjust our environment, we can maybe adjust a difference in the way that we demand of the autonomic system. For example, we could potentially drink a little bit more. And of course, when you're leaking, one of the first things that we do is try and stop drinking water. So of course, drinking a little bit more clear fluids will allow us to try and put more into the bladder itself. And if we modify our activity levels and stay relatively quiet, but we're still filling and we're not leaking, then our bladder is stretching. If our bladder is stretching, what's the sphincter doing? Working. Because something is working, even though we're not in control of it. So that's one way that we could actually do it. So, and by storing more urine, so not giving in to the urge to go all the time, not constantly seeing a toilet and think, well, I'll go there because I don't know where the next one might be, but in fact, trying to make a conscious effort to actually have a bigger bladder volume. Now, I know what you're saying, you know, the problem with that is that the bigger the bladder volume, the more likely I am to leak. So therefore, I'm kind of caught between a rock and a hard place. But in fact, if you reduce your activity levels, so say when you sit down, you leak less than when you're moving around like a blue-ass fly. So therefore, the best thing for you to do, certainly in the early stages following surgery, is maybe to rest up a little bit. Maybe to spend a period of time just trying to fill your bladder. And for the people that really struggle to do that, the really heavy leakers, and this is where, again, it starts to fit in that you target your intervention for the specific kind of leakage that you get, because the very heavy leakers may benefit from external penile clamp use. Because if they can't ever store any urine at all in their bladder, their detrusor muscle itself will reduce its compliance. It won't ever be stretched. If I don't stretch my biceps regularly, my biceps will naturally contract. And so we want to make sure that the bladder compliance is continued to be maintained, and maybe, possibly, potentially, use of a penile clamp might be a way that we can achieve that. So for my patients that are very, very leaky, we'd say to them, okay, for 2 to 3 hours in the morning and 2 to 3 hours of an afternoon, I want you to use the clamp and I want you to try and get that sensation of an urge. Because do you know what the sensation of an urge is? It's the bladder reaching a stage where it starts to contract automatically. Now, if you can get that to contract, the sphincter muscle's relaxing, you can take the clamp off and urinate. Once the bladder finishes its emptying cycle, the first thing that happens is the autonomic sphincter starts to want to kick in again. It's a natural process. So possibly, and again, there's no evidence behind this at the moment, but possibly we can start to stimulate the body to find its own rhythm again, where it's kind of got off the beaten track a little bit. So this is certainly something that I'm using with some of my heavier leakers. Again, people that suffer from urgency and frequency, okay? People that have had radiation therapy, for example, and the base of the bladder has become challenged by the radiation, and it's fibrotically challenged. It doesn't like being stretched, it's irritated. Sometimes we can actually use medication to assist with that process. So things like Betmega and Vesicare can be useful for a period of time to calm the bladder down, to allow it to again start to store and empty. And we're trying to resume that normal filling and emptying cycle. So what you're looking at here is something that we would definitely do for most men. We would definitely try and address their bladder volumes and try and address their fluid intake, because there's no downside in what we're trying to achieve here. We may need to encourage them to reduce their overall activity levels, because if they're going for a two-hour walk every day and leaking right the way through that whole period of time, well, they're pushing beyond the capacity of the sphincter to function. So it's kind of a little bit crazy to keep failing over and over again. How does that make a muscle achieve its outcome? So what we might have to do is to slow ourselves down a little bit, reduce our activity levels in the first place, and then gradually start to ramp things up from there moving forwards.
Excuse me, Stuart. Yep. How does this penile clamp work?
So an external penile clamp is basically, it's just a piece of plastic that's got some padding front and top and bottom, and it is like a clamp. So you put your old fella in the middle and you clamp it down and you lock it off, and it compresses the urethra and the penile tissue and stops it from dripping. So it's, I think that sometimes the surgeons or sometimes many people can be concerned that if you're clamping a penis for too long, you're stopping the blood flow. But that's why we'd really kind of quantify that by saying that you'd only want to do it for a couple of hours at a time to go through that normal filling emptying cycle. But for some people that are very, very leaky, I think it's actually a useful thing, because it enables them to go out and have dinner with their partner. It enables them to go out and have fun with the grandkids. It is an enabler of activity that would otherwise be unable to perform. And for a short period of time, that can be very valuable in making you feel like a contributor to society again. When, if you're leaking that heavily, you tend to just lock yourself in the house and you never come out. So I think it has a role to play. But it's a very simple device, and there are lots of them on the market at the moment. And again, you know, one clamp might not work for one person but works for another. So again, it may be worthwhile for someone kind of shopping around and trying a few out and seeing what works best for you as an individual. So what we talked about was autonomic training. Now we move on to voluntary training, because we've now identified the muscle. We've gone through that real-time ultrasound-led feedback process so that we can identify the muscles that are more anteriorly located around the urethra. And then the next stage is to say, well, hang on a sec, well, what are we training for? You know, what is the problem here? So if we're training to try and make the muscle stronger, and this is a contentious point, we're not sure if the muscle is weak after surgery. We don't know. We assume that if you undergo any surgical process that involves sectioning through near a muscle, moving that and stitching it into place in another location, that that surgical trauma induces a degree of atrophy. And that means that the muscles kind of doesn't want to work in the early stages. If I have a shoulder reconstruction and they stitch the muscles together, the shoulder becomes weaker as a result of that exposure. So there's no reason to think that there may be a little bit of weakness in the tissue following surgery. And of course, when we train for strength, we're training hard. You know, no pain, no gain here, fellas. Okay, but we're not necessarily training fast, because the faster I try and recruit that muscle, the less accurate I become. And if I'm more familiar with recruiting through my back passage, as I start to increase the demands in terms of the strength training, I can lose the focus on accuracy. So again, training using feedback that can lead you to identify the muscles more accurately can be followed up with strength training that can still maintain that front end bias. Is it speed that we need? Now, again, for some people, when they leak, it's when they move suddenly. If you get up out of a chair quickly, you leak. But if you get up out of a chair slowly, you don't leak. So there may be a problem with how quickly the muscle can react to situations. And if I want to train a muscle to be faster, I have to train it fast, but not necessarily hard. And so you can see that's a very different way of training. And what we're looking at doing with speed is to really improve its reaction time, to go from zero to hero and off again. And so rapid contractions would be a good way to kind of try and train that specifically. Do we need to train for endurance? Again, when we think about it, when those people are saying to us that they're leaking only towards the end of the day, is it really important that we make the muscle work really hard or really quickly? Because in real terms, that's not where the muscle fails. The muscle fails with extended activity at the end of the day. So for endurance, we've got to be gentle and more sustained. And in fact, thinking about the pelvic floor and its location in our body, it's the base of a cylinder, and we'll go through that in a second. But in fact, postural control may be a way in which we can improve the endurance capacity of the pelvic floor.
Stuart, on that slide, that strength, what's anterior bias?
Anterior bias is that what we were talking about before, the front end. So you want your penis and your testicles to be working harder, but not your bottom. And that's this concept of anterior bias means that we're trying to work the muscles responsible for urination, because you never leak urine out your back passage. So it makes sense that that's what we're trying to target. The other thing that we can train for is stability. So for some people, it's when they move suddenly, when they change position. Okay, it's a more dynamic function. And again, what we try and do is remain functional during inertial challenges. So when we change the bladder suddenly, that the pelvic floor can support it in that motional challenge. So these are different things that we've got to look for. And therefore, what we really might have to do is figure out where we fail and then target those specifically for training. So it's not as simple as just doing your pelvic floor exercises. It's how do you do them? Do you do them hard? Do you do them quickly? Do you do them and focus on your posture more than anything else? I have some men that I don't give any pelvic floor exercises to at all. With this postural cohort, it's very unusual that I need to give them pelvic floor training exercises. Going back to this concept of the posture, what we can see on the screen at the moment is how the diaphragm, that dome at the top, and the pelvic floor underneath, and then this transversus abdominis that wraps around us, forms what we call our core component, or our core muscles, which I'm sure you hear about quite a lot. It basically forms a cylinder. And what we know from studies is that, in fact, when you breathe, your pelvic floor and your diaphragm kind of should mirror each other. They should move like a piston in a piston tube. And I'm not much of a mechanic, but I do know that if you bend a piston tube, it makes it a lot harder for the piston to run up and down it. So therefore, if I'm slouching, if my posture's bad, okay, if I'm not sitting or standing or walking with good postural control, I reduce the efficiency at which that relationship is kind of sustained. So therefore, it makes a great deal of sense that when we're trying to coordinate the diaphragm and the pelvic floor as the ceiling and base of this piston, that we think about, you know, maybe stacking the cylinder better. Okay, so if you think about where your body is, you really want your head on the top, your ribs underneath your head, and your pelvis underneath your ribs. And I know that sounds very obvious, but the number of times that we kind of don't do that, or that we sit and we kind of, you know, fail over time. So what we really have to do is to try and think, well, in order to optimize the capacity of my pelvic floor to function, I've really got to stack this cylinder better. But it's interesting, it's not just stacking it on a one-off thing. So doing things like Pilates or doing things like core muscle training. If you go to the gym and you train your core really hard, how long would we go to the gym for? An hour? Maybe two if you're really keen. Pilates classes run from 45 minutes to an hour and a half. We are against the force of gravity from the second that we get out of bed until the second that we go to bed. We're either sitting or standing or walking. If you're lucky, you're lying down, but that hasn't happened to me in a long time. But that's the case. So therefore, what we're looking at is a hell of a marathon. And so to train for a marathon, you can't just train in 5K intervals. You can't keep running a 5K race every single day and at the end of 6 months expect to rock up to the Boston Marathon and finish in third place. You can't expect to finish at all. What you've got to do is run progressively longer and longer and longer distances. So posture isn't about kind of this. It's about this right the way through the day. And of course that's difficult to get your head around when you think about training, because we want things to get better straight away. We want to do this and we want to feel better tomorrow. And yet training, I can't train anyone for a marathon inside 16 weeks. It's just not possible. We need to condition them for that. So postural changes need to take time. You need to expose yourself to that again over a period of time. We mentioned functional training, okay? And this is kind of the next level over. So, okay, let's take it as read that we've identified the right muscle. We know we've done this anterior bias. We know that by shortening the penis and scrunching the testicles up, we create this front end sensation. We try and reduce the dominance of our back passage to kind of contribute towards that sensation. We then develop the intensity of the contraction. We develop the speed at which it can react to situations. We might bounce a little bit and shake our bodies to kind of challenge the inertial concept of it. Once all these things are working, we really need to then integrate the pelvic floor into how we move. Because if I've got a problem getting out of a chair, I leak straight away, I need to make it specific for that activity. You need to identify what is it that actually makes you leak. And again, if you're using a pad all the time, constantly, sometimes you just don't know anymore. You don't know what makes you leak because the pads are so good at what they're doing that you can't get that sensation. Sometimes what's worthwhile doing is to actually try and reduce the use of the pad a little bit so that you actually, oh, I felt that then. And what was I doing at that moment? Okay, that's when my brain needs to make this connection better, more consistently. And if I can make that connection consistently again and again and again, then it starts to become more practiced. Pad phasing can also be used, interestingly enough, as a motivator for improving postural control, because if you leave it off for an hour, okay, and work on your posture for an hour, and then that you're dry, that's all good, maybe leave it off for an hour and a half or 2 hours, but still work on your postural control. And you can gradually extend that period of time and phase your dependence on the pad down and work towards a solution in that fashion from there. So pad phasing can be used in a number of ways. Yeah, so what you've got to produce is a voluntary effort of your pelvic floor at that specific moment in time. So if it is just before you stand up, you need to think to squeeze to stand, but squeeze in the right place before you then move. Of course, once you've done that over and over again, we might need to make it more challenging because muscles only respond to stress. We only adapt if we're stressed. If we're never stressed, we keep cruising. And so therefore, if we vary the bladder volume when we're going through that movement process. If you do it with an empty bladder, it's much simpler. You're much less likely to leak. If you do it with an hour and a half's worth of urine in the bladder because of the extra inter-bladder pressure, you might find that you leak more often. So start with something that is successful. Maybe 10 minutes of urine in your bladder after you've been for a week. That's the time that you can do your movement-based exercises and succeed in staying dry when you do them. If that's consistently successful, maybe try it at half an hour. Maybe try it an hour after urination. And that's a way of adjusting the actual exercise complexity. The same with the intensity, the speed at which you move. Because all of these things will adjust the challenge on the sphincter. And if the sphincter succeeds, you stay dry. And if the sphincter fails, you've just found your level of failure. So back up a little bit. Modify your own individual exercises to suit you rather than to suit everyone around you. This is the biggest question that I get asked by men that have been doing it for a while. I'm bored now. Okay, I'm doing it, but how long before I can stop doing it? Do I have to do this forever? I would say no. You don't have to do this forever. And the reason is that I drive a car. I'm sure most of you do. And when I get in the car to go for a drive, I don't consider that I'm practicing driving a car. I don't consider that I'm improving my skill set. But I am. Every time I get in the car, I'm actually doing things that are now, for me, automated. In fact, I can put my seatbelt on, put the ignition on, and shout at the children, and check my blind spot, and pull into busy traffic without really thinking, what am I doing here, where am I going? It doesn't even matter. Because although those things are voluntary activities, I've practiced them often enough that I've shifted them towards a more automated state. So if we can identify the muscle and integrate it into movements, and that movement can be successful and we can practice that again and again and again, our pelvic floor will become part of the way in which we move. Whereas right now it might not be. The P plate concept's a great concept to take into mind. We put P plates on the cars of learner drivers because they don't have that automated shift yet. They're still making mistakes. They forget to check their blind spot before they forget to put their indicators on before they change lanes. They make mistakes. Well, in this period of time, your body may still make some mistakes. You still may intermittently leak. You may not be 100% bone dry. You were better than initially after surgery, but you've hit a bit of a point where you feel like you're not changing. But if you're never practicing, if you're not still practicing the same thing over and over again, why would your skill set improve? And that's one of the biggest issues that we have, is that, you know, people quit too early with exercise. They don't give it long enough, or the exercise that they've got is just the wrong exercise fundamentally. You know, it still comes back to this concept that they may have been identifying the wrong muscle in the first place. The only exemption to this rule is that people that have been exposed to external beam radiation therapy, well, that's ionizing radiation that's passed through the muscle tissue and the bladder as well. So therefore, it has the effect of making the muscle less pliant over time. It makes it less able to do its job properly. I think these people, probably the answer to that question is yes, you do. Okay, but for people that have just had straightforward prostate surgery and have never really had exposure to radiation, there's no reason why they can do it. But again, just to reiterate the importance of compliance and practice in exercise. If you pull out too early, you know, and a real great example of that is Arnold Schwarzenegger. You know, you look at how, you know, his meteoric rise in the 1970s, and then if you look at him today, he's not exercised for a while. He looks a bit like me, to be honest. Okay, muscles can come and they can go, and we have to keep pushing to kind of maintain a degree of muscle activity. So before I go on, is there any kind of questions that you want to ask about what we've kind of talked so far, and then we're going to touch a little bit on erectile function?
Thank you very much. It was great listening to what you're saying. Just a question that my professor, I've had my prostate taken out at 10 months ago, and you recommended you use a penis pump. Does that anything to do with a penis pump?
The penis pump's much more to do with erectile function.
Oh, okay.
And we'll talk about that in a second. But in terms of continence, I don't think the penile pump has any effect on continence whatsoever, either positive or negative. And in fact, some people notice that as they use the pump or as they kind of stretch the penile tissue, in fact, continence in the early stages gets worse. There's a condition called climacteria, which is around kind of sexual activity. You notice that your penis leaks more than it does, even if you're fully continent. And in fact, that's a clinical condition. And what we normally see is that with ongoing pelvic floor training, often climacteria reduces. But again, it's exposure to that exercise over a significant period of time that often produces the outcomes.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah, I'll go.
Providing everything else is equal, what sort of time period are we looking for?
It's a great question, because what we often see is a natural process of resolution. The human body is a wonderful thing. And when you have really talented and skilled surgeons that really work hard to preserve the actual tissue around the prostate itself, we manage to get some amazing sparing operations that are done, not just the nerves, the actual muscular tissue and the supportive tissue around it as well. And so as technology improves, I fully expect to see an earlier return to continence than we've seen previously. But some patients that have a more complex body to dissect, some patients who have larger prostates, these are all much more traumatic operations. Cancers that are kind of very closely located to where the muscular tissue is have to have a clear margin around that area of resection. So these are reasons why sometimes there is more trauma to the tissue. If you're thinking about rehabilitation, when we talk about the levels at which we rehabilitate, in order to identify a muscle, we're probably talking in the region of around maybe 2 to 3 weeks using biofeedback. I reckon I can teach someone in that period of time, you know. In order to develop the strength or speed or endurance, you're talking much more like the 3 to 6 month period, okay? And that's just muscular development. It is what it is. You can't fast track that process. And then in order to make it automated and functionally independent of the way that you think about it, you're talking probably like about 18 months to 2 years, which is the P-plater concept. That's how long we keep a P-plater on a car. So in other words, that's the time zones that we would look at functioning in. Now, we can have people that are dry within 2 weeks. I've had patients that the catheters come out bone dry, away they walk. But they're obviously people that have had less of a traumatic exposure to the operation. And they're just the lucky ones, I guess.
You talked about the right exercises. For that anterior
bias,
I've been to many physios and they seem to come up with slightly different exercises all over the place, right? Is there any meta-analysis of research that's coming together that's suggesting that there is a particular exercise that should be done?
Meta-analysis, no, for the simple reason that almost all of the research that's been done on continence has been done predominantly on female continence with childbirth, because that's the lion's share of where we are. Where we are in research in male continence mechanism is 20 years behind the female counterparts. We know that pelvic floor exercises following childbirth is level 1 grade A Cochrane review evidence that is what's necessary for women following childbirth. That's undeniable. The most recent randomized control trial that was done by Catherine Glazner actually showed that physiotherapy for post-prostatectomy incontinence was completely a waste of time, and in fact was no better than a handout. When I, as part of my master's thesis, I have to do literature reviews and actually review these scientific papers. Her paper was based on teaching men how to do pelvic floor exercises via digital rectal examination. And this is where you kind of go, maybe that's why the actual outcomes of the study were so poor, because fundamentally she's targeting the wrong muscle to teach men to recruit in the first place. So it's kind of, this is where we need to evaluate the literature that's being revealed. And in fact, the work that we're doing up in the University of Queensland at the moment is looking at using transperineal ultrasound. And a study that was done last year by Ryan Stafford actually showed that the two verbal cues that produced the most amount of movement on the real-time ultrasound scans were to shorten the penis or to pull the turtle head into its shell. And that's in the scientific literature. So it's this anterior indrawing sensation. And what we're really trying to do now is to discourage the overriding anal sense that wants to run over the top of that voice. If you've got an overactive kid in the corner that keeps shouting, pick me, pick me, pick me all the time, you've got to get it to be quiet before the little voices can be heard. And sometimes that process of early learning is what we need to achieve. And that's where I think the big changes will be seen over the coming years.
There was a reference in your background to pelvic floor muscle pain. I just wonder what that sort of referred to.
How to answer that and stay on point. There are some men who suffer with penile, testicular or anal pain in association with urgency and frequency. Sometimes they have pain on ejaculation, sometimes they have pain just with achieving erectile function. And sometimes they just have pain in the lower abdominal region or in the perineum. We don't know why they start with it. Sometimes it's called prostatitis. And the treatment of choice by urologists is often just to treat with high-dose antibiotics. What we now think that for a percentage of those patients, in fact, the pain that they get in through that region may be because the muscle fibers are working at too high a level. So again, when we've been talking here, we've been talking about muscles that have been quite damaged and on the low end. If I constantly react to pain all the time, my muscles end up in a very hypertonic position, almost the other end of the spectrum. And rather than the pelvic muscles being like a deep cereal bowl, often they can be more like a saucer. And as they jam the prostate up into the bladder, that can cause the frequency and urgency problems that we sometimes see in conjunction with pelvic pain. So what we do, as what I do, is look at strategies by which we can allow men the ability to find where their pelvic floors are, either low or high, and try and find the yin for their yang, so to speak. You know, and so not all patients are given the same pelvic floor exercises. Some people I give reverse Kegel exercises for, to actually actively relax the tension in the muscle. Because if my muscles wound up like a spring, I can't do any exercise up there until I first of all let it go, and then I can start to exercise, but then I've got to remember to let it go at the end again. So there are different people that present in different ways, and certainly people with pelvic pain we often find have this much more of a reactive kind of presentation.
It's 20 years now since I had my radical, or 19 and a half years, and I've 8 years since I had radiation. But my biggest problem, I can go 3 or 4 days completely dry. If no...
Say that again, sorry.
I go probably 3 or 4 days without...
Yep.
Completely dry.
Yeah.
But a day that I'm concentrating on something, like I sometimes make furniture, so you're setting it out and working out the measurements, next thing I'll wake up, I'm just wringing wet.
Yeah.
Because it gets cold. It can happen during the lawn, but... I can then go for other days and might urinate 3 times during the day. And the next week, I might do it for 5 days straight where I go every hour.
Inconsistency.
Yeah.
It's a nightmare.
It is. And I don't know which day is going to be which.
But, you know, if I'm a gymnast and I don't practice regularly, my performance when I come to actual competition is inconsistent. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yes, it does.
So, therefore, again, you may have committed to the program for a bit, and then come away from it because it wasn't working, because for you, or it works to a degree, so therefore I don't need, and men work on this principle, if it's not broken, don't fix it. And therefore, if it's good for a couple of days, I don't need to do the exercise anymore. I'm good, I'm fixed, I'm fine. Ah, damn it, I had a bad day. I'll go back on the exercise again. Boom, bust, boom, bust, boom, bust. And what we really need is consistency in that approach. You know, but again, for you, whether it is that you're not exactly isolating the right muscle in the first place, that's something that we just don't know. And again, that comes back to technique. So there's a number of different reasons why it might be. And that's the difficulty. When I see a patient, there's not one overarching kind of direction that I have to take them. I have to very much look at them and try and figure out, like a bit of a game of Cluedo, you know, which bit is going to work for them specifically. And that's the skill of the clinician. Any other questions on continence?
Yes, I have. The place for the use of the sling or the artificial sphincter.
Great.
That's really not
good
what
question.
You're talking about, but it's when what you're doing doesn't work, sort of.
I'm a physio, and one of the things I dislike most about physios is that you can get caught in a physio wheel. Yeah. You can go to physio again and again and again and again and again and again, and it just stretches out and there's no end point to it. Well, in fact, what we do is we actually quantify people's incontinence. So if you measure your 24-hour pad weight scores, okay, and we see that they're reducing as with exposure to exercise, then you're getting better. If we have someone that comes down and then they start to plateau, and we've applied these principles to them, and they're still plateauing, they're not changing, you know, and we've worked with them for 6 months, we've trained them really regularly, and they've been consistent and compliant. Well, once we've gone beyond that kind of six-month period, we're then starting to think, well, hang on a second, it may be that the degree of trauma that was done has not left me with enough muscle to be able to build or work or develop. So for these people, then surgery is the next logical choice. What I have managed to do on a number of occasions is actually manage to get patients that are very, very leaky, so over a kilo of urine per day produced into their pads, I've managed to get them down to a point where, in fact, they're more amenable to a sling operation and less amenable to a larger artificial urinary sphincter, because unfortunately the heavier the leakage, the more you tend to veer towards the internal sphincter emplacement. The lighter the leakage, the more likely you are to benefit from just the sling operation. And part of my success is to move someone from that group into that group. That I would consider a successful intervention. But it's all based on outcomes. So if your outcomes aren't changing in what you're doing, either you're doing it wrong or the physio is doing it wrong. But either way, someone's got to hold their hands up and say, it's not working, and therefore we move on from there. All right, so we'll move on to the fun bit. Erectile dysfunction and penile rehabilitation. And I guess the first thing that I really want to say when it comes to this is that erectile function isn't the same as sexual function. I'm really not that interested in what you do with it when you get it. Not at all. It's above my pay grade. But I am interested in blood flow. And blood flow is really vital. It's important that my brain gets blood flow. It's important that my muscles get blood flow. It's important that my heart gets blood flow. And so it's equally important that my penis gets blood flow. And in fact, overnight, a normal healthy man will get maybe 6 to 8 erections every night as they go through rapid eye movement sleep phases. Now that's not because in the middle of the night we want to procreate. It's because we need blood flow, and that the body has figured out that even if we're not particularly sexually active as a human being, we still need nightly housekeeping blood flow movements. Now following surgery, the neurological trauma, and again, if you can remember back to that first picture that we showed where the prostate had all that web-like stuff coming around it, that's nerves. And the surgeon has to peel those nerves away from the prostate, like trying to peel a tangerine, pluck it out without any trace of pith on it. That's a pretty impressive trick. If you could do that, you'd be pretty impressed. Now, the surgeon has to do that robotically from outside or openly, you know, by using their own skill set. It's an incredibly skilled surgery, but it will always induce some degree of neural trauma. It might not have damaged the nerves, but remember that nerve-sparing operation still causes neurological trauma. Okay, the process of introducing air into the peritoneal cavity causes a degree of neural trauma. And so therefore, it's really important that when you're not getting these regular blood flow movements, that we actually try and facilitate that process. Because blood flow is vital in preventing penile fibrotic change. The penis has got big blood cells, big blood-filling cells on either side, called the corpus cavernosum. And blood rushes into that, and blood comes out of it. And that's when we get erect and flaccid. Now, if we're not pushing blood into that tissue, the tissue itself starts to contract in on itself. And so penile shrinkage that we're aware of following surgery isn't because they've cut that little bit of a prostate out and taken a tube out, because that tube's designed to stretch anyway. It's because there's a lack of blood flow that doesn't stretch the tissue, and therefore the tissue tends to just become fibrotically challenged. And that fibrosis doesn't just happen in one dimension, it can also happen and cause curvature to the penis, which is when Peyronie's disease comes in as well. Remember that neural regeneration, recovery from any kind of neurological event, whether it be a stroke, whether it be a nerve lesion, okay, is incredibly slow. I think they rate it around 1 millimeter per month regrowth. So, of course, that's why when you take a prostate out that's that large, the surgeons are saying 12 to 18 months, because that's about 12 to 18 months regrowth time. So we expect to see some signs of change over that period of time, but it is a slow process. And if we just wait for the nerve to regenerate of its own, it's got 12 to 18 months of fibrotic change in that interim period. So what we've got to do is we're really killing time. That's all we're doing. We're maintaining penile health while the nerve is undergoing this natural process of resolution. And that's all that we're trying to achieve. But like anything, we actually need some degree of strategy. It's all well and good to think about rehabilitation in terms of muscles, but in fact, erections need a degree of rehabilitation as well. And the first thing is actually use it. Now, I'm not talking about using it in a sexual fashion. I'm saying grab a hold of it and massage it. If you're in the shower and you can see that you can have an effect by squeezing it, then squeeze it, because you're moving blood into the tissues. You may not get a full erection, but even if you get a thickening of tissue around that region, that's blood moving into the tissues. There's never any downside with doing that. Continue with pelvic floor exercises. We know that the exercises, especially the faster exercises, can function a bit like a pump. And sometimes if you can start massaging the tissue, grab a hold of the penis and then contract your pelvic floor, you can almost feel the pump-like effect that the pelvic floor muscles have on the actual quality of the erection. So again, continuing with pelvic floor exercises, even if you're continent, can have a beneficial effect. And in fact, there's a lady called Grace Dory, a professor in the UK, who did a landmark study. Now, albeit these men didn't have prostate surgery or prostate cancer, and these were men with erectile dysfunction, but her tagline was that pelvic floor exercises can be as effective as Viagra. So the evidence is out there that, in fact, yeah, if we continue to do pelvic floor exercises, they certainly will do us no harm. But just stopping them because we're continent, we may be losing out some benefit in actually continuing along with them moving forwards. Use drugs. Viagra, Cialis, Levitra, they're wonderful things. They actually will help in terms of maintaining, again, this endothelial dose of blood flow into the equation. Okay, and there's lots of ways to use them. You can use them as in terms of a daily dose, just regularly, just to keep the system ticking over. You could take it as a booster dose just prior to sexual activity. Okay, but using the drugs is a really important way. If they're just not working at all, maybe the drug needs to be injected, you know. So we you've got to think about it outside the box. And no one sticks their hand up and volunteers for the injection one. No one wants to do it. But if it's a way of getting blood in and out of the penis, then it's a useful and a worthwhile endeavor. Pumps fit into the system. Now, some of the surgeons like to come away and say, well, in fact, I don't like the pump because we're drawing venous blood back into the penis because we're creating a vacuum. Whereas when you use drugs or when you use an injection, you're actually getting an arterial vascular response, which is like a normal erection. But the thing is, though, that at least you're getting blood moving in and out of the blood cells. That's still a good thing. There's no downside to stretching the tissue. So, yes, it's not ideal. It's not arterial blood. And, yes, it's coming backwards into the tissue. But if you do it under a low pressure, you're not going to damage any of the tissue. And, in fact, you're going to maintain the stretch to the tissue, maintain the health of the penile tissue. Remember, we're just killing time here until the nerve regrows. So we use whatever strategy works for us. And it may be we use a number of those strategies. Use penile rings. So, okay, we've managed to use the pump. Low pressure system. One pump every, I don't know, minute or 2 minutes, just to try and slowly get the erection developing within the pump itself. Once we've got an erection, the minute we take the pressure off, down she goes. So we can use a penile ring as a form of a tourniquet, if you like, to trap blood in the penis. Now, again, that's not whether you want to use it or not. That's entirely your business. But if you can sustain it there for another 5 minutes with a penis ring, you're improving again the stretch response to the tissue. You've maintained that blood in the tissue for longer. You've optimized the health of the tissue. And again, this is things, you know, unfortunately, the sexualization that we live in this world at the moment, you know, these things and pumps and drugs, they're all perceived to be deviant things, you know, like they're pornographic things. And I think we need as clinicians to kind of remember that, in fact, they have a huge benefit, a massive benefit for a great number of our patients. We can't just move away from it just because it's kind of, it doesn't feel comfortable for us. We need to address this straight on and use injections, like I said before. So it's not a case that one of these works. It's not a case that two of them work. And it's not a case that you need to try any one of them in any combination. It's really a completely individualized approach. Whatever you can do to kill the time that you need to maintain the blood flow until then this neural and trauma just starts to calm down, and then one day you wake up and all of a sudden you've woken up and you've got a natural erection. You've got a morning erection that kind of starts to kick back in the system. That's what we're really kind of looking for. There is no one right solution. Keep an open mind. It's really important to talk to your partners. It's really important that you kind of don't think inside the box the whole time. But it's an individualized approach. And again, for some people, it's really a case that if intercourse is just completely off the cards, then maybe the focus for us is in fact to focus on intimacy and outer course, rather than looking at can I physically achieve sexual intercourse. You know, if we stop looking at intercourse as being that kind of goal, maybe we change the way that we interact. This could be a good thing for us to kind of look on moving forwards. And again, asking for help, you know, it's very difficult, it's a very awkward thing to ask for help from. But GPs, psychologists, sex therapists, there are lots of people out there that are now trained that want to help to kind of create a change in this. And of course, getting physically fit, you know. We know that erectile function and cardiovascular health are linked. So therefore, it makes sense that where you can, try and push your body a little bit harder. So, in summary, there's no, for continence and erectile function, there is no one size fits all approach. I think there's too many physios that try and give a kind of a textbook, recipe book approach to improve continence. And I just don't think it exists. I think that the new research that we need to do as scientists needs to be about classification of continence better, and then targeted treatment specific for the type of incontinence that you have. That's what I think it needs to happen. So get what's best for you, and don't just follow the masses, and don't assume that you've got it right. Cancer, continence, potency, they're all important. As much as we try and kind of push the ones that maybe we're not so good at, oh, that doesn't matter so much, they're all an important part. And sexual health is a very important part of defining who we are as individuals. So it's really important that we don't just get caught up with the cancer side of things, and we don't just get caught up with the continence side of things. Potency too is also really quite important. And it's different for different people, but it's still worthwhile knowing that you really need to kind of talk about it. Shameless self-promotion. So, and this isn't just about coming in to see me. This isn't about just me. This is about if you need help and advice. It's about if you need to know things that you might not know about. Then that's the email there, or that's the website, that's the phone number. You can get in touch with me, and we can try and see if we can kind of guide you through a process of what you need to do moving forwards. But I'm in the process at the moment of training other physios. So I run courses for other physios to attend that we're starting to try and get to change the way that we look at treating men's health patients.
Just two things. In relation to Viagra,
yep.
The professor recommended that I have half a tablet twice a week. Now, what it does to me, it gives me a headache.
So, yep.
So, but the reason being, is that for more blood flow,
yep,
in the body?
Yep. It's to try and maintain the health of the penile tissue.
Okay.
And that blood rush that you get, that hopefully it's, yeah, not just up, fair, to that head, it's down to that one.
So
as
I'm
well.
Not the only one.
No, and if you can tolerate it, that's great.
Yeah.
You may find that with repeated exposure, you get more and more used to it over time.
Okay.
But if you don't, you could maybe even try a 25 milligram, so a quarter of a tablet, on a daily or bi-daily dose. You've got to try and take whatever you can tolerate that creates an outcome.
Just one other thing, in relation to erections, when you get an erection, you don't have a result at the end of, you know what I mean?
Well, in fact, orgasmic function is still there. So you can still achieve orgasm, but you'll have a dry ejaculate. Yeah, so there won't be anything that comes out. But it is still possible to achieve orgasmic function even without an erection. So that's, again, something that men need to know about. That, in fact, you know, if you think, oh, well, I've not even got vaguely hard enough to get an intercourse working, well, that doesn't mean that you won't achieve orgasmic function. So you still can, by engaging in outer play, by engaging in intimacy, you may even find that you can get back to some level of a degree of intimacy and orgasmic function as well.
Thank you. You mentioned like the importance of getting the blood into the penis and whatever, and having the radical changes that, and then radiation changes your ability to do all of these things. Now, if you're moving on to the next stage, as some men are, onto the hormone treatment, that is going to...
Oh, that knocks it right off.
It's going to knock it right off. So, with the blood flow...
Yeah, it does, but it also, more than that, it actually knocks off your libido, which is the biggest thing. So, therefore, you just don't feel like it. And, of course, it's very hard to generate erectile function if you just don't feel like it, even vaguely. But there is still benefit in getting blood flow into the penis, and that's where things like the pump can be of benefit, or injections. You can actually inject, get an erection, and still have a low libido, and so that's it's not easy. It's very difficult, but there is still worthwhile trying to maintain decent blood flow to the penis, whatever stage you're at.
And will those tablets or the injections change incontinence at all?
No, normally the penile injections, again, are really specific for generating an erection itself, they don't have an effect. But having said that, you know, there's a line of thought that says if you're getting an erection and you're actually engaging in sexual play, that in order to sustain an erection, some muscles have to work at a higher level. So there's a line of thought that says, well, in fact, some people that do start to re-engaging in sexual activity actually do start to notice an improvement in their pelvic floor function.
So do the hormone treatments change the incontinence at all?
No, not normally. No. That's normally, they're normally completely irrelevant to that process.
Thank you.
Hello there. Thank you for the talk. I'm one of those people 12 years ago had radical surgery and did everything I was told, but unfortunately I've never regained my potency. But I do use injections, which work.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to say to the meeting, you know, I'm fighting a battle with HCF. They used to subsidise those injections up till March this year and withdrew the subsidy. And I've tackled it from every direction into the National Health to find out what happened. And it's because they're paying a subsidy for returned servicemen who have lost their potency through war injury. And because of that, the HCF have said, well, now it's subsidised, therefore we won't. And I'm fighting them all the time and getting nowhere. And I just thought I'd let everyone else in the room know if you wanted to join the battle. I think we should be able to get a little bit back from the cost of these injections that are so
essential. I agree.
I think
sexual health is a very integral part of what defines us as a human being. The World Health Organization actually defines it as part of human existence, sexual health. So I completely agree with that.
Question to you, with your service you're offering there, you're saying that pelvic floor exercises might help?
Potency? Yeah. Well, yes, but only, they certainly won't hurt, put it that way. But with someone that's been...
Help.
Yeah, but they certainly won't hurt, to put it that way. But what I'm saying is that if someone has been completely denervated as a result of surgery, if they've had non-nerve-sparing surgery, no amount of pelvic floor exercises is going to help them. So again, it really does depend on the degree of surgical trauma that you've been exposed to in order to rid yourself of cancer.
I had nerve sparing.
Yeah, so it
never returned.
Yeah, but again, that's what I'm saying, is that nerve sparing is a term that is about the two major nerve bundles on either side. It doesn't take into account the web of Aphrodite that actually encircles around the prostate itself. So there's still a degree of neural trauma that's been performed as a result of that. And also, as much as surgeons, you know, they try their hardest to preserve the nerve tissue. They try their hardest to spare the nerves, but sometimes it's just not physical or visible to them that they've actually damaged the nerve tissue. It's not like the nerves are white and the rest of the tissue's blue or green. It's all mixed in there. It's a very complicated operation. So there may have been more trauma than you thought there was at that moment in time. But it's still worthwhile trying to stimulate penile recovery. And if injections work well for you, then that's fantastic. And if injections don't work, there is implant surgery as well. So there are further alternatives going on beyond that.
I'm just hoping someone's going to fight HCF. Like, oh, it'd be nice to get a little bit of
this. Certainly would.
If someone important could emphasise to.
I would love to say that I was important, but I'm really not. You got a question?
Is ultrasound the only way you can pinpoint those two muscles?
Yeah, at the moment. Because real time, if you think about giving feedback on performance, you've got to be able to do it in the moment. And the only way that we can see things in that moment would be is ultrasound. There's just no other way. They tried to use what's called electromyography, which is where they put sensors on the skin, but it's not sensitive enough to dictate which muscles are firing, which aren't. It's skin surface stuff, so you can't detect the differences. Ultrasound, we can see different movements in completely different directions. And so that's probably the intervention of choice.
Just your point about the pelvic floor exercises. To do it correctly, do you have to go through a whole training program, or is it as simple as just drawing up and pulling back?
Everyone's uniquely individual, and if they're naturally proclivit in their back end,
yeah,
and that's where they go from, then we need to look at that and actually give people feedback. There's no, like, I could tell you that the right cue is to shorten the penis. Mm. Or to scrunch the testicles up, or to pull the turtle head into its shell. They're the things that we know keep it front-ended. But really, until you're looking at it on the screen and getting that individualised feedback, I there is no one way. And this is the hard thing, is that often when you come and see a physio, you want the solution. But the solution for you might be different from the solution for you and for you. And so really, the skill of the clinician is being able to pick what intervention is necessary. And that really, unfortunately, only comes through, you know, the better the quality of the suit, the more you pay the tailor for it.
And second question I've got, with the use of drugs like Cialis, what sort of duration would you say before you just say, well, they're not going to ever work?
You know, it's interesting, because sometimes we find that they don't work in the early stages very well at all, and then you might take them a month or two later and suddenly it just starts to work. I do think it's a degree of when the nerves are starting to recover, the drugs have their optimum effect. Mm. So if they're having no effect whatsoever but just giving you horrible side effects, maybe just draw back for a month or so and then give it another go in another month, you know. Certainly with Cialis, it's very expensive. Mm. It's actually worthwhile, you know, intervening for a while. If there's really no difference, then draw away and then maybe come back into it a little bit later. Again, there's no right or wrong with any of this stuff. Okay.